The PSV session 1, Advancing Sustainable Agriculture Through Process-Based Crop Modeling in the Era of Climate Change, which would be discussed by Dr. Vangimala Reddy, Research Leader, USDA ARS, ACSL, Beltsville, MA, USA. This session would be on video conferencing, so let's have that.
Hello everyone, I just wanted to make sure if you are seeing the screen correctly. Okay, can you hear me well? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay, well, okay, that's great. Okay, yeah, that's great to know. Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank AgriVision 2024 for inviting us to deliver a talk. And I want to send a special thanks to Prasad Das, who helped us to change this presentation from in-person mode to virtual mode. Vangimala Reddy is a research leader at Adaptive Cropping System Laboratory at USDA ARS Beltsville. He was supposed to come there in person and deliver this lecture, but due to some reason he couldn't travel. So on behalf of him, I'm going to do this presentation. My name is Sahila Begum. I'm a visiting agricultural engineer at USDA ARS, and I'm also a research assistant professor at the University of Nebraska, Lincoln. For today's talk, the topic is Advancing Sustainable Agriculture Through Process-Based Crop Modeling in the Era of Climate Change. Let me start with the climate change term itself. Climate change refers to the evident long-term change in the climate patterns. We know if we look at the global temperature variation over the years, there is an increase in 1.1 degrees Celsius since the pre-industrial level. This is mainly due to the increased amount of greenhouse gases that have resulted in the global warming. And if you look at another greenhouse gas called as carbon dioxide, if you look at this graph here, which shows the increase in CO2 from 1960 to 2020, there is an increase from 320 ppm to currently it's around 420 ppm. This is also due to the increase in fossil fuel usage, deforestation, and land use changes. If you look at the methane concentration, that have rise up to 1923 ppm in 2022. This is mainly due to increase in production and transport of coal and natural gas, and also due to the livestock, from the livestock. With the increase in global temperature, there is also increase in ocean warming. If you look at the increase in ocean warming since 1880, there is an increase of 0.69 degrees Celsius. This is combined effect of both greenhouse gases, which have resulted in the global warming. So as the temperature in ocean increase, there is also an increase in sea level rise. This is data from 1993 to present. There is overall increase of 100 millimeters since 1993. So this is due to mainly two reasons. One is due to a process called thermal expansion, and there is, in addition to that, there is also melting of ice. When we talk about melting of ice, there is a mass variation in Antarctica since just estimated since 2002. We can see that there is a rate of change of 146 billion metric ton per year since 2002. This melting of ice sheets is a cumulative effect of both greenhouse gas increase, which have resulted in increase in temperature followed by the melting of ice. So should we be really worried? That's the question. And the answer is yes, we should be worried because it affects the life on the earth. So some of the key sectors that are affected by the climate change are agriculture, ecosystem, water resources, energy supply and use, transportation, human health, and society. So in 2022, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change said this: the scientific evidence is unequivocal. That means there is no doubt there is climate change happening, because there are enough and more evidence now. And climate change is a threat to human well-being and the health of the planet. Any further delay in concerted global action will miss the brief, rapidly closing window to secure a livable future. It just says that there is only a very limited time to take an action, and this action should be taken at a concerted global level. That means a collaborative level, a collaborative effort at the global level is very necessary to tackle the adverse impact of climate change on the earth, various sectors on the earth. Now let's see what are the challenges posed by climate change on agriculture. As I mentioned before, due to the increase in greenhouse gases that have resulted in the overall increase in the temperature and climatic variation, there are extreme weather conditions that we are observing. Extreme weather condition includes extreme precipitation, extreme droughts, heat stress, etc. This have greatly influenced the agriculture in terms of production. The growth and development of crop itself is being affected. And there is also alteration in the growing season being observed in different parts of the world. And research are also showing that there is an increase in pests and diseases. With the increase in CO2 concentration, their growth and reproduction is also enhanced. And there is shift in agricultural zones. The soil degradation is happening, soil quality is reducing, and this is ultimately affecting the supply chain of the agricultural production. There is something that is complicating this challenge into a more complex stage. That is the increase in population. Currently in 2024, right now, we all know that the population is currently 8 billion, fast crossed 8 billion. And by 2050, the world population is set to surpass 9.1 billion. That is 34% than what the population is right now. And the food production for this increased population has to be increased by 70% to meet the need. So we already have the issue of climate change challenges. In addition to that, we also have to tackle this requirement of more food production in the future. So these both together makes the system complex to address. Here I'm going to show some of the examples how climate change could affect the agriculture and is affecting the agriculture. Some of the examples are on different parts of the world and some are specific to US. In the first figure, if you can see, this shows the length of growing season in US. Length of growing season is the time between the last frost event in the spring to the first frost event in the fall. So that is called as the length of growing season. So if you look at from 1890 to 2020, the average length of growing season in USA have increased by more than 2 weeks. There is an increase in length of growing season by 2 weeks. So it can have both pros and cons to the agriculture. The advantage that is that it can allow farmers to diversify the crop, and it can also allow farmers to have multiple harvests from the same plot. But at the same time, the research have shown that with the increase in length of growing season, there is also an increase in the invasive species and weed growth, which can affect the agricultural production. With the increasing the length of growing season, it can also alter the ecosystem, range of and types of animal species and soil microbes, etc. And the right figure, this is to show the number of drought events from 1970 to 2020 and the projected increase from 2021 to 2030. As you can see here, there is a clear evidence that number of drought events are increasing. It increased from 7 in 1970 to currently around 22 in currently around 19 in 2021. Just looking at the projection from 2000 to 2030, you can see that there is a drought have risen up to 30% globally since the year 2000. So drought, it can affect the plant growth and development, and also it can put more pressure on the irrigation requirements for the crop, for the agriculture. I would like to take your interest into this figure here. This figure represents the productivity of maize in US. So the y-axis on the left, it shows productivity in kilogram per hectare, whereas on the right side, it shows the total US production in million metric ton. If you look at this, you can see there is an increase over the years. This is mainly due to the technological improvement in terms of advanced machineries and technology in terms of sensor, using sensors for irrigation and new cultivars, etc. So obviously there is an increase in productivity, but at the same time you can see in some years there are reduction in the yield, though the overall increase is in the positive direction due to extreme climatic conditions. Some years are drought, some years have wet spring, early frost, and unusual climatic events can reduce the yield. So which gives a clear hint that climate change, even if we have technological improvement in improving the overall productivity, the climate change can clearly lower the yield production, the productivity. As I mentioned to you before, there is extreme events are also increasing. So when extreme precipitation happens, and sometimes they can be flooding in the agricultural farm. So flooding can also affect the crop growth and development. I want to take your attention to this figure here. This shows how the plant growth and development under different duration of waterlogging. This is for the cotton. So the cotton was subjected to waterlogging at the two leaf stage, starting from 0 days of waterlogging, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, and 14 days of waterlogging. And then all the parameters were measured and analyzed in terms of growth and development. Just highlighting just two of it, which shows that photosynthesis and the whole plant dry weight in continuously waterlogged condition were 75% and 78% less compared to 0 and 2 day waterlogged plants, which shows how much effect the waterlogging can bring into this crop growth and development. This is another experiment that shows the impact of wheat growth under current and potential futures carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere. These are the control chambers in which one is set to 380 ppm of CO2 and the other is set to 680 ppm of carbon dioxide. And both plots were equally treated with herbicide, but when the CO2 increase, there is an evident increase in the amount of wheat that is grown in the chamber, which shows that this may put more pressure on the use of herbicide in the future when the atmospheric carbon dioxide is increasing. The right figure shows how the temperature affects the plant growth and development. This is the day and night temperature in cotton. So up to a temperature of 27 day and night temperature, the cotton plant is going to grow well. Once it crosses the optimum temperature to a higher temperature, plant growth is affected in a negative way. So up to a certain temperature, the effect can be linearly high, but if it crosses a threshold, then the plant growth and development can be affected. This effect is different for different crops. So in summary of climate change factors and general impacts on crop growth, the climate variable carbon dioxide is projected to increase, and this increase, the general impact on crop growth is that there can be an increased net photosynthesis and transpiration use efficiency. It can reduce the transpiration, increase canopy temperature, and reduce crop nutrient concentration. Temperature, which is also projected to increase, both maximum and average temperatures, minimum and average temperature. A general impact is that it can help in reducing the frost risk, but at the same time there can be increased stromatal conductance, photosynthesis, respiration and transpiration, faster growth and development, phenological shifts, reduced transpiration efficiency, and an increase in temperature could result in increased heat stress. The projected rainfall is observed to be varying across the globe in the future, so it have both positive and negative impacts on the crop growth. Solar radiation, the projected trends are reduction in solar radiation and increased diffused light fraction. The increase in diffused light fraction could result in increased photosynthesis and growth. So one way to understand how climate variable interactively affect plant growth and development on different processes of plant growth and development can be by using process-based crop simulation model, which can be a key tool in assessing and addressing the impact of future climate change. So process-based crop modeling involves simulating the growth and development of crop based on the underlying physical, biological, and environmental processes. So in process-based crop models, all the processes are mathematically represented at a mechanistic process level. So these models, the existing process-based crop models, have a mechanistic way of simulating the photosynthesis, respiration, it can have phenology, soil water dynamics, how much nutrient uptake and utilization, so climate impact in terms of when the temperature change, carbon dioxide change, vapor pressure change, relative humidity, all this impact can be represented back to how it affects the photosynthesis and then carbon partitioning, etc. And pest and disease simulation, crop management practices like irrigation and fertilizer, and stress factors, water, nitrogen, and heat stress can be mechanistically brought into the model. And canopy architecture, root growth and function, and crop genetics can also be incorporated in a process-based way. So these process-based crop modeling could be a potential solution, a solution for understanding how this complex climate variation can affect the crop growth, and also help us in developing solutions to improve the yield, at the same time protecting the environment. So I'm going to show some of the application of process-based models towards climate change analysis. So this is a simulation that is carried out for the US, for the eastern seaboard region, which includes 13 states from Maine in the north to Virginia in the south. So in this simulation, the future climatic simulation scenarios have considered the shift in the carbon dioxide, temperature, and rainfall from the baseline of 1970 to 2000. So here, the bottom figure on the left shows the change in temperature and the precipitation for the simulation up to the mid-century. Here you can see that there is a shift in maximum daily air temperature. The average temperature have increased plus 2.9 degrees Celsius, and whereas in terms of precipitation, there is an increase in 10%. So how this increase in temperature and precipitation along with the variation in the COT affects the yield? This is simulated using process-based crop model called as spudsing and mazing. So based on this two model simulation, it is observed that for the potato, the yield can decrease up to 42% in this zone, whereas for the maize, the yield can reduce up to 20% in this zone. So this gave a spatial variation on how the yield variation could happen because of the climate change. Process-based models can also be used for analyzing the spatial variation as well as over the entire in a global level. For example, this is a study by Jonas in 2021, which have try to understand the variation at a global scale, in which the simulation have shown that maize shows a decrease in the yield from minus 6% to minus 24%, mainly due to the warmer climate projections in the regions where maize is currently cultivated. Whereas for the wheat, which is more expanded in the high latitude, it have a positive projection in terms of yield. There is a yield gain from 9% to 18%, and this is linked to the higher carbon dioxide concentration, and also it is mainly located in a high latitude area where a positive increase in the temperature is helping it to grow well. So this kind of simulation can help us to know how the geographical location play a critical role in affecting the crop growth and development, and also the yield. So for this also, the process-based crop models can be used. More details can be read from this reference here. Okay, now coming to another application of process-based crop model is to know whether crop switching can help in the future, reducing the reduction in the yield because of the climate change in the future. So this is a study by Rising et al. In 2020. What they have tried to understand is if we are following the same cropping pattern currently followed to the future, then they estimated using the process-based crop model that there could be up to a drop of 31% in the yield for the six major crops that is grown in USA. But if we are allocating or switching this crop to other locations, which will positively help these crops to grow in a better way, then we can reduce the loss up to half So this the last figure, which is shown in 2070, when reallocating the crops to different locations, it can reduce the impact of yield reduction. So these kind of analysis can also be taken carried out using the process-based crop models. Last application, but not the least important one, the insects and pests. As I mentioned you before, insects and pests growth and reproduction is highly dependent on the environmental condition, like how much carbon dioxide and temperature and moisture, etc. So this is a study that have looked into crop, pest and climate interactions to understand how much yield loss could be there in different regions in the world for due to the increase in the insect and pest damage on the crops. So in this study on wheat, rice and maize, yield loss to insects was found to increase by 10 to 25% per degree Celsius of warming, and this is more influence or more hitting hard in the temperate zones compared to tropical and other zones. So now that we saw many application of process-based crop models, if we use it after understanding the fundamentals and the mathematical functions in the crop models and using it effectively, can really help in understanding how the crop agriculture is impacted with the climate change, and also it can also show some light to what could be the possible alternative measures or possible management conditions or management practices or cultivar new genetic improvements that can be built to tackle the effect of climate change on agriculture. Along with the positive side, there are also some challenges and limitations for the process-based models. Process-based models can be really complex because they have mostly more complex interactions taken into account, like genetic, environment and management interactions. When simulating this,